Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Good afternoon, everybody. It is the Steve Jones Show on a Thursday. Matt Catrillo here with you. Steve will soon be there from the Sunbury Motors Studio, Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford, Kia, Hyundai, lots of pre-owned inventory, a great service department and sales staff, and it's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. They got you ready for whatever you need. You're buying a pre-owned or new car. You got to get your current car in for a fixin'. They got you covered with our friends at SMC. We got so much to get to today. But first, before we get to the news of the day of the beard coming to Philly, you want to pass along this note for those who haven't seen yet. Penn State football season opener at Purdue, likely a Thursday night. Thursday, September 1st is now the season opener for Penn State. Don't really get it, but I know that this is something the Big Ten has been trying to do, these stupid Thursday, Friday games. I don't like the sound of that. We'll see what Steve thinks on that and if he had any inside scoops on that. And today, as we are continuing Super Bowl week, though we're going to be consumed in a lot of basketball talk today, I'm sure, Ross Tucker from the Ross Tucker Football Podcast going to join us at 3:35 for his thoughts on Super Bowl 56. Probably get into a little college football with him and more. The King with us today as well. We're going to do our Super Bowl picks. We're going to do prop bets, all this sorts of fun stuff. We're looking forward to that at the end of the show. Plus, we got a betting segment for you as well. So, lots of good stuff to get to today. But let's get to that news of the day. James Harden, officially a Sixer. James Harden and Paul Millsap coming to the Sixers. Ben Simmons, Seth Curry, Andre Drummond, and two first-round draft picks heading to Brooklyn. ESPN's Adrian Wojnarowski with those details. So, coming into today, I mentioned on the show yesterday that I'd be cautiously optimistic with Harden coming to Philly, but I'm excited now because you have a GM in Daryl Morey who has pulled off a trade to get a guy like James Harden, a stud like James Harden, and you're able to trade away a nobody like Ben Simmons. I mean, that in itself is just remarkable. Plus, the Sixers can keep Matisse Thybulle and Tyrese Maxey. The fact that you can pull that off in itself is just remarkable work by Daryl Morey. You knew Seth Curry was probably going to go, but you know what? You're going to get that shooting capability with James Harden. And then some, a guy who can do multiple things, of course, with the basketball and being just a scoring machine. All right, we knew that was coming. Don't love losing Andre Drummond. I know you get Paul Millsap in return. Hopefully he can play out better for the Sixers than what he's done with the Nets so far, but I would rather Drummond. If you ask me to choose one or the other, I'd rather Drummond than Millsap. But I guess something's got to give. Also, trading two first-round picks along with Drummond, I don't love. But I still think, all in all, this works for both sides. Because you still have a lot of question marks with a guy like Ben Simmons and all that's happened with him. And sure, there's some question marks with James Harden, his hamstring problems, his whole mindset, give or take. But I was encouraged by this, though. Is Shams Katrina just tweeted out a little while ago that Harden is definitely committed to the Sixers for next year, as he, as part of the trade agreement, will sign the $47.5 million extension for one more year. So he is at least with the Sixers next year. So that gives the Sixers this season and next season at least to try and do something with James Harden. Going to be a big cap hit, I get that. I'm a little surprised that Tobias Harris is still on the roster, but I guess something just didn't get done before three. Because there were rumors yesterday the Sixers were trying to move his big contract to bring in Harden. So we'll see how that all plays out. But overall, you look at the Sixers starting five. This is just the way I see it. We'll see how this is played out. But I see Maxey at the one, Harden at the two, Tobias Harris at the three, Matisse Thybulle and or Danny Green at the four, and then you have Joel Embiid at the five. I mean, that's a really good starting five. And maybe Tobias Harris became motivated with all this and was able to right the ship a little bit with his play. He's been playing really well as of late, but overall has kind of been underwhelming for the Sixers since he signed the deal. Maybe this changes something. Maybe this opens things up now that you bring a guy like Harden in. Who knows? But either way, when you look at that starting five, the Sixers definitely have a chance to compete now for a championship. So I overall give myself, give a Daryl Morey a thumbs up for this. This just a remarkable day for the Sixers. And then all signs pointing to March 10th, that's when the Sixers and the Nets next play each other in Philly. I can't imagine what that's going to be like, especially if Ben Simmons plays. Now we wait to see when Harden makes his debut. Sixers have a two-game homestand. They play tomorrow night against the Thunder. And I believe Saturday night? Yes. Back-to-back games. You got the Thunder tomorrow, Cavs on Saturday, which is a big game for the standings. Then you get, really, you're the Sixers. You get tested right away with this. Cavs, Saturday. You got the Thunder tomorrow. Home against the Celtics Tuesday, at Milwaukee on Thursday, who just acquired Serge Ibaka as well from the Raptors, who basically were in the midst of a fire sale. And then you're at the T-Wolves, too, on the 25th. So right away, the Sixers will be tested, depending on when James Harden comes in. But overall, I'm okay with the trade. I think it's worth taking. Especially, and I feel better about the trade now, despite losing Drummond and two draft picks. I don't like that combination. But the fact that...
Are you still talking about Harden and Simmons? Come on. That's a university. It's a university in Texas. Harden Simmons.
Is it? I don't know.
Oh, for good. Are you involved in sports? I actually did a basketball tournament once where Harden Simmons was in the tournament. At the old Reunion Arena in Dallas, which is now a field. I know that you now feel this is it. You're over the top. You've won.
They're in position. I'll say that because there are some other moves that I like from the other East teams. That's still going to make it difficult.
So let's go through the championship lineage of James Harden. Okay, we're done. I'll do it. Played for one title in his career as the sixth man with Oklahoma City. Dip. With Durant and Westbrook. That's it. Now, let's go to the nuts and bolts of the trade.
All right.
First of all, I give ESPN credit. They have had the ability to take moves like these, like any kind of NBA move, and make a gigantic deal out of it. Breaking news, like on, you're sitting like on, most of this stuff is like just interchangeable parts and means nothing to the race. This actually is a trade that does have significance, that like is a legitimate breaking news trade, because it is two teams that think they have a shot to win the East. The Nets, I mean, despite losing eight in a row, they're still in the five spot. So the Nets have been playing decently until this drought. The Sixers have Joel Embiid. They didn't have to give up Maxey. They haven't moved Harris, from what I know. And what did I tell you yesterday? Which player would be thrown into the seal on the Sixers side? Which player did I tell you yesterday on the show?
You said Drummond, I think, right?
No, I said Seth Curry.
Oh, yeah, and Seth Curry. Yeah, we all knew that.
No, Seth Curry's name was not being mentioned. It was Maxey's name that kept being mentioned. It was Tobias Harris. I said, I think they'll settle for Seth Curry. Like, just enough to do that. Well, that's what they did, because you just can't just give away, like, okay, here we go. It's like, no. So the Nets get a player that can't shoot, is an excellent passer, is an excellent defender, also hasn't played a second in 11 months or 10 months, right? That's what they get. Curry's going to be a nice compliment that's going to give them, like, you know, because Durant can't take every shot when he's back, and Kyrie Irving can't take every shot when he's allowed to play, okay? But Curry will be the kind of guy that, you know, the shots that they don't take, he'll take, and he'll make a pretty decent amount. The first-round picks are irrelevant. They're irrelevant. If you're really good, you're going to be picking back of the pack, and it's only the first eight picks that have any meaning in the NBA draft, usually, anyway. In general. So, I mean, look, I think it's a really good trade for the Sixers. I think it's an excellent trade for the Sixers. They're going to get a guy that's at least going to play for them. But, again, it's going to be how do they all play together, right? James Harden is not going to Philadelphia to be the star. He is going there to be 1B. Joel Embiid is the star. He is 1A. Harden's 1B. And he has to understand that. He's a very ball-centric guard. And you've got a center who's an MVP candidate that you've got to get the ball to. I know you always hate when I talk about in terms of strategy and like actual like court terms.
Well, I was getting into that, the X's and O's, before you jumped on. I do want, the only thing I guess from an X's and O's standpoint that maybe would slightly concern me, but I think ultimately it'll be okay.
He's too ball centric. He is an absolute ball centric player, and those are the exact words I used when Houston sent him to Brooklyn. I haven't changed my tune. When he went from Houston to Brooklyn, I said, this is interesting. He is such a ball-centric player. And you've got Durant and Kyrie Irving, and Irving's a ball-centric player. So nothing's changed in my assessment of James Harden. It's the exact same words I used when he went from Houston to Brooklyn.
I didn't get the move either at the time, because I think you had too many real big names trying to play with one ball. But at least with the Sixers, it's him and Embiid running the show. I don't care what anybody says. And I think that's easier to transition into than what it was when he went into Brooklyn. Because in Brooklyn, that's Kevin Durant's team. That wasn't James Harden's team. It's not even Kyrie Irving's team. It's Kevin Durant's team. You're absolutely right. But when Natalie's in the Sixers, it's his, at least for the next two seasons, because he signed the extension, was part of the deal. It's him and Embiid's team.
It's Joel Embiid's team. He's 1B. Sorry, but that's the way it is. Embiid is an outstanding player. What he's going to have to do is he's going to have to go in and he's going to have to play nice. He just can't. I'm going to take over. I'm going to hold the ball. I'm going to take over. Hey, look, you see the guy down there? That's the best player on the floor. It's not you. You were the best player on the floor when you were in Houston. That was a few years ago. Okay, now you got to go and you got to, you know, this is, to me, it's got to be about how badly does James Harden want to win a championship? It's all about how badly does he want to win a championship? Reason being, is he the kind of guy that will check the ego and check part of the game in at the door because you need that to win? Okay, remember, Oscar Robertson, was absolutely the show with the Cincinnati Royals, but had nothing to show for it except, obviously fame and money, which is, you know, what you live for, fame and money. But he wanted a championship so badly, he went to the Milwaukee Bucks and he checked his game in at the door because they had Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. And they got their championship. But Oscar Robertson checked in his game at the door. Now, this is different. The game's a different game now than it was in 1971. But Oscar Robertson was a ball-centric guard that changed his game because he felt he needed to do that to win a title. James Harden is going to have to do the same thing in Philadelphia. Because the first shot he misses, they'll boo him, and he'll regret he signed the 2-year deal. He goes, these people are booing me. Welcome to Philadelphia.
Because he was booed in Houston anyway. That's why he left Houston to begin with.
Well, then he's going to leave Philadelphia in 2 weeks. Because remember, in Philadelphia, the fans there are real. You've told me that. We're real. Okay. How's it working for you? Working real well. Sign those free agents. I don't want to go there. All right.
They've got Harden for 2 years. They got him for this season and next season. And he's back with his guy, Daryl Morey.
And you're still not passing out Milwaukee.
I still think they're going to be a tough out now that they got Serge Ibaka. That was a really good depth move for them. I will
Ibaka's
say that.
He's had to battle injuries this year, but
right.
that's the kind of move that actually helps a team out because Ibaka's not going to come in and demand anything.
Exactly. Again, that move worried me.
No, I woke up today. I slept well last night. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Taking your calls at 800-795-9565. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, best in new inventory, great pre-owned inventory. With the Sunbury Motors Guarantee, all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia Routes 11 and 15. Hummel's Wharf and online at sunburymotors.com. He is the host of the Ross Tucker Football Podcast. And you can check him out on social media at Ross Tucker NFL. And also, of course, myfrontpagestory.com, which is phenomenal, which we'll talk about a little bit later in this. Ross Tucker, welcome back. Happy New Year, my friend. Great to have you with us.
Yeah, Happy New Year as well. Good to talk with you, Steve. Thank you for having me.
All right. So, look, you've done your fair share of a lot of, with NFL games this year. when I look at these two teams, you know, you're a lot like me. You look at units, and I don't mean the offensive unit, defensive unit, like units. And I think the best unit on the field is the Rams' defensive front, and I think the worst unit on the field is the Bengals' offensive front. How do you view it?
Yeah, I think you're probably right. The thing I would say about that, though, Steve, is that was definitely the case in the Bengals' game against the Titans.
Yes.
And I don't know if it was the case against the Chiefs, but with Frank Clark and Melvin Ingram and Chris Jones, the Chiefs have a pretty good defensive line as well.
Yep.
And the Bengals' offensive line was still not good. So I guess what I would tell you is everybody knows it, right? Like, you know, the Bengals know their offensive line isn't great. The Rams know the Bengals' offensive line isn't great. You know it. I know it. So it's really incumbent upon the Bengals' coaching staff to make sure that that's not the reason why they lose the game. And they've been able to do that, kind of. And they've won the games against the Titans as well as the Chiefs. They're going to have to do it again. And there's lots of different things you can try. You can try to run the ball more. You can do more two tight end sets to try to chip out the defensive ends on the way out there. You don't have to worry about them as much. You know, you can get the ball out of Joe Burrow's hands quickly, more play action on first down. There's a lot of different things they can try. And so we'll see what they end up going with. But they've done a good enough job to get him here.
Which then brings us to Joe Burrow. What kind of job in reality has he done, considering let's at least couch it by saying the Bengals' offensive line is good, they just aren't great. Right? What kind of job has Burrow done working around that?
Yeah, unbelievable. He's extremely impressive. I was on the sideline for the AFC Championship game, and it was really interesting because right after the game, I got to interview Joe Mixon, like less than a minute after McPherson made the kick. And Steve, he was crying and very emotional. You know, I think it's probably pretty well documented. He had a horrific incident his freshman year at Oklahoma.
No doubt, terrible. Yeah.
And it's on video, and a lot of teams wouldn't touch him in the draft. And I think he was just so appreciative of the Brown family and the Bengals for giving him that chance, which is why, you know, he went out of his way to just thank them and get emotional. But the point I was going to make is, like, 3 minutes later, I interviewed Burrow, and in those situations, they'll tell you, like, hey, you got 3 seconds, right? You got three questions. I'm sorry, not seconds.
Right, yeah.
You got three questions. And I can't remember the first one I asked, but he was so relaxed as I asked him that first question that I immediately changed my second question. I said, Joe, you just won the AFC Championship game. You're going to the Super Bowl. How are you so calm right now? And he was like, well, you know, I was excited right when Evan made the kick, but we kind of came here thinking we would win the game. We expected to win the game, and you know, it took us a little while to figure things out, but once we did, we were able to do. I mean, he's the calmest, most relaxed, chill guy I think I've ever interviewed.
You know, what's interesting about that is when he transferred from Ohio State to LSU, he played the 1 year before the awesome season. And in the 1 year, the first year he got to LSU, he was good. He wasn't great. He was good. It's amazing the transformation to his last year at LSU, where he was phenomenal, and he's been phenomenal, it seems, ever since. That's what's always struck me about him, is that the first year he went to LSU, he was good, but not great.
Yeah, isn't it amazing? It really is. It's fascinating. Listen, I was talking with some people recently, Steve. I mean, you know, I guess both his dad coached there and his brother played at Nebraska. So
yeah.
Joe wanted to go to Nebraska, but Nebraska had already signed Adrian Martinez, so they said, no thank you. Like, it's just unbelievable. Yeah. Like, you go back and read some of this stuff, it's just unreal. I mean, Nebraska could have Joe Burrow, but they're like, no, we got Adrian Martinez. I mean, it's the transfer portal for quarterbacks has been fascinating, but your point about the transition he made from year one at LSU to year two, it's like he was a different guy. He was good year one, but by year two, he was amazing. I mean, the guy's never lost a playoff game. You know, which sounds silly. It's only his second year, but college football playoff or NFL playoff.
It's amazing. So you're watching the game. I thought a key defensive player in the Chiefs-Bengals game that you worked that day was Mike Hilton. And Mike Hilton, I'm going to guess at some point or another, is going to get Cooper Kupp, who's exceptional. So give me Kupp's side of it as to why he's really good, and then give me Hilton's side of it as to why he might have a chance to cover him.
Yeah, so they're going to go against each other a lot because Cooper Kupp plays in the slot a lot. Mike Hilton is one of the best nickelbacks in the NFL. That's going to be a head-to-head matchup a lot. I think the thing that jumps out to Cooper Kupp is McVay does an awesome job always making sure he has a free release, meaning he has space to get into his route. He's not getting jammed at the line of scrimmage. He's got a free release. Well, once he has a free release, the corner is just in trouble. Yep. Whoever's trying to cover him, he has an unbelievably unique ability to make every route look the exact same. So, you know, when you're covering him, he has no tendency. He has no – by the time he gets on the corner and then makes his break, the corner really has no idea which way he's going.
It's phenomenal. You're absolutely right about free release, because when Devontae Smith was at Alabama, as you and I have talked about, they put him in the slot so nobody could get a jam on him. And you know, and he got free release almost all the time, and that's what happens with Cooper Kupp. Cam Akers' presence in the game. He may not be quite 100%, but what advantage does he give the Rams' offense that maybe Sony Michel can't?
Well, I think he's got a little more juice, for sure. Although, it's interesting, McVay's talking like Darrell Henderson is going to be back and playing for the Rams, and all three of those guys are going to play, which I think is really interesting. And Akers, you know, he's fumbled a couple times. So I guess I just wonder the level of confidence that McVay has in him. Very curious to see how much the Rams run it. They like to run it, but how they divvy up those carries, my guess is he'll go with the hot hand, whoever that ends up being.
Your thoughts on Matthew Stafford? Because obviously he was brought in to be a cut above Jared Goff. I think everyone would think he is. What have you thought about his level of play?
Well, he's played extremely well. Now, I mean, I guess the one negative is I think he leads the NFL in pick sixes. And yeah. I do think for the Bengals to win, there has to be a turnover or two at least. And maybe even a defensive touchdown. You know, Hilton's good at it. Jesse Bates as a safety is really good. So I do think that that's a pretty big factor. And that, you know, the Bengals' best chance is Stafford has a couple picks. I'm really happy for him. You know, you got to think when you're in Detroit, you know, is this ever going to happen for me? And now he's at least in the Super Bowl. He wanted to play in big games. Now, I really want the Bengals to win, Steve, just because I know what it was like for Eagles fans when they won for the first time ever 5 years ago. And that would be amazing for Bengals fans. And I don't think there's really that many Rams fans, so I don't really, you know, I'm not rooting for them. But if the Rams win, I'll just be so happy for guys like Matthew Stafford, Andrew Whitworth, to be doing what he's doing at his age. You know, Eric Weddle, even Aaron Donald, who's been so good, so deserving of, you know, winning a championship.
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up Aaron Donald. That was going to be my next question anyway. Ross and I have done this so many times that he kind of anticipates where I'm going, which is interesting. But when you've seen him in person, now look, defensive players, let's get something straight. He's probably in on one out of every seven plays. Now, most defensive players are in on one out of every 20 plays. You know, maybe, you know, one out of every whatever. But he's in on one of every. That's a high percentage. What makes him effective when you see him?
Well, he just has incredible natural explosion combined with unbelievable technique. You know, you don't get to be at that level without having really all three things. And believe it or not, a lot of D linemen in the NFL don't have all three, which is tremendous physical ability, tremendous motor and want to, and then the impeccable technique. A lot of guys, everybody in the NFL has at least one of those. A decent amount of players have two. Having all three is rare. You know, believe it or not, there are guys that have incredible ability. They just don't have the motor. It's such a tiring position. They just can't do it that many snaps a game. Then there's the guys that, you know, they've got the motor and they've got the physical ability, but their technique's just not there. You know, at that level, it's so much more about technique than anybody ever realizes.
I say the best for last, because this is a big weekend, and it's not just the Super Bowl. MyFrontPageStory.com. We've talked about it before. This is a phenomenal gift, and it's a great weekend to do it, isn't it?
Well, yeah. I mean, it's been really cool. We've been killing it, Steve. So many people have been getting these stories for their significant others for Valentine's Day. People get it for birthdays and Mother's Day as well. It's kind of funny. I've actually been helping to write some of the stories. So for people that aren't familiar, you have a story written about your significant other, and it looks like it's on the cover of the newspaper. It looks beautiful. It's framed. You know, they almost always cry when they read it because they just see the quotes from you, like, I just never tell her how much I appreciate all the little things she does. It's just, it's a really emotional gift and a truly unique gift that they get, and cool for me to watch. But we've gotten so many, Steve, and I'm in on the business now that I've actually had to, over the last week or so, help write some of the stories. So the other night my wife wanted to watch Netflix. I was like, nope, I need to go write some love stories about women other than you. And she thought that was pretty much. She's like, when I met you and you were a football player, never did I think that part of your career would be writing love stories like this at night. But that's exactly what I've done. So if you're listening, get a story at myfrontpagestory.com for your significant other for Valentine's Day. Might even be me writing it for you.
Even better, myfrontpagestory.com. Okay, so many of you are out there searching for, I got to find something. Here's your solution. And not only that, Ross might even write it. All right. Awesome. Hey, Jack Ham sends you his best, by the way. So,
awesome. Tell him I said hello. I truly enjoy listening to you guys, and I'm excited about what Penn State's been doing from a recruiting standpoint. And, you know, I'm from the Reading area, so
yep.
I've been hearing about Nick Singleton since he was in eighth grade. I'm very excited about what he can do. I met with Javen Williams and his family Saturday morning before he committed. He goes to my high school, Wyomissing. So I'm excited about what Penn State's been doing on the recruiting trail and hoping it can mean really good things.
Thank you for doing this. And again, one more time. Look, you're all searching for a gift. I know you out there. MyFrontPageStory.com. And it's going to be something to sit back and go, wow. Ross, thank you so much.
Of course, Steve. Thanks for having me, man.
Ross Tucker joining us on the show. Matt didn't hear any of it. He's been researching all of James Harden's stats.
I'm just soaking it all in. That's all.
Okay. And then when they hit the roadblock in the playoffs, well, he wasn't worth it. I can hear it now. I can hear it now. This actually is setting up beautifully. Do you want to know why?
Why is that?
You are on an emotional high right now. Which means when the crash happens, and it will, you'll be inconsolable.
I don't know if I want to go that far, but there will be some urgency into how things can be put together for next year. Let's say that. A lot rides on next year, no matter what happens this year.
Why don't you just follow my lead on this stuff and just be just like, okay, we'll see how it works out.
I've tried. It's just not in my nature.
It's not in your DNA?
It's just not in my DNA ever since I became a sports fan. Just ask my father.
You know, it's interesting. The suit went with myfrontpage.com, but he had the story written about himself. All right, we'll come back with more in a moment. A lot of flowing quotes, though. We'll come back with more in a moment here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Get the lingerie on the deck. Call the janitor.
When car repairs get difficult.
Well, I just don't know.
Me neither.
We get good. Sunbury Motors. More than quality new and used cars, Sunbury Motors specializes in complicated auto repair diagnosis. They can handle intricate repairs and even complete auto body with service open Monday through Friday, 7 till 4. And Sunbury Motors has made simple repairs easy. Maintaining your vehicle is necessary. Finding the time to do it is difficult. Welcome to Sunbury Motors Quick Lane. Open 7 till 4, Monday through Friday. Just walk in or call ahead. Relax in their remodeled waiting room with Wi-Fi, beverages, and snacks. Will Sunbury Motors factory trained techs take care of your oil change, tire alignments, brakes, and inspections. Quick Lane, 6:30 to 6, Monday through Friday, Saturday, 6:30 till 2. Sunbury Motors, Ford and Hyundai, North 4th Street, Sunbury. And Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. We take the out of auto repair.
This has been the goal of Daryl Morey since the day he arrived in Philadelphia. He wasn't able to trade for James Harden with the Houston Rockets. The Brooklyn Nets did. And now, just a year later, Harden has essentially forced his way out of a second team in consecutive years. He goes to Philadelphia. He's been paired with a lot of stars in this league. And he gets a new one. Joel Embiid, a new co-star.
And how's it worked out with the other ones? Okay. Just thought I'd mention it. I feel like I'm killing your party here.
Not going to let you do it today. I'm enjoying myself.
In existence for 75 years and two titles. All right, great. It's like kind of like your baseball team. All right. No?
Well, I don't worry about the baseball team, so there's that.
Yeah, it's not like that's been a bevy of championships either over the last 20 years. But you got one?
Yeah.
And it was with a guy who's been, you know, like tested positive?
Oh, my almighty!
No, I'm just asking. I just want to make sure I got the right guy. No?
No, you're correct.
He actually had a really good season in 2009. No. All right. We've had fun with the Super Bowl. We got the King on today, by the way. I know you've been... we're going to pick the Super Bowl?
Correct. And I've got many prop bets ready. And I think you're going to like some of these.
That's great. I can't wait.
We're going to do our usual game score... game pick, score, and MVP with all the other prop bets that I've come up with.
By the way, you know the Penn State-Purdue football game got moved to opening night.
Correct, and I'm not a fan of that.
Thursday, September 1st. No, I'm fine with it. What's wrong with that?
I think Thursday, Friday night games are stupid.
Yeah, but it's the open of the season. No. This isn't in the season. This is the opening night. I've always been a fan of the, because it doesn't disrupt any part of your schedule by playing it.